And there's humour that's musical and visual and verbal, as in this introduction to one of his less well-known musicians.
For our next tune, we'd like to feature the star of the band. He's played with all of the major bands, such as the suave Stan Kenton, the wonderful Woody Herman, the lovely Lawrence Welk, without any more ado, ladies and gentlemen, may I present now the inimitable, the incomparable, the dynamic, the soulful, the formidable, the magnifique Pee Wee Moore.
A name scarcely anybody had ever heard of, but it was Dizzy's baritone saxophonist, who then steps forward and plays just this. Horace Silver's Doodlin', played by Dizzy Gillespie at the Newport Jazz Festival. You're listening to Diggin' Diz on BBC Radio 2. I'm Guy Barker. The big band we just heard was put together in 1956. The one Dizzy formed in the mid-40s had become too expensive to run by 1950, and since then he'd been working with either his small band or the all-star touring group Jazz at the Philharmonic. But there were recording sessions by special one-off big bands, and he was invited to play some of his arrangements with a local rehearsal band in Washington, D.C. Announcer Willis Conover, who was also a DJ for the Voice of America radio station. It may be this contact that was responsible for Dizzy becoming the first jazz man invited to tour overseas with a band subsidized by the US State Department. Digby Fairweather.
It was a very important position, and it was musically as well a very considerable one because the musical results were so great. Unquestionably, he would have been proud, as a black American, to suddenly become a representative for the entire white and black society.
Dizzy's State Department Band, with personnel assembled for him by the young Quincy Jones, who wrote that piece, Jessica's Day. Later, when Quincy became a staff producer for Mercury Records in the early 60s, he signed up jazz people like Roland Kirk, Milt Jackson, and, when he was free, Dizzy, which led to another sort of big band album.
Dizzy Gillespie in the Double Six of Paris. That was a beautiful thing. The people that were involved with this particular record were big fans. It was them singing the big band charts. Mimi Perrin wrote all those lyrics. Lalo Schifrin was a big fan, wrote the arrangements, and it was just a big lovey-dovey thing.
Recorded in 1963 with the vocal group The Double Six of Paris. That same year, Dizzy became involved with American politics. Jimmy Lyons, who worked on those early broadcasts for the Armed Forces Radio, joined up with journalist Ralph Gleason, and as directors of the Monterey Jazz Festival, launched a new candidate for the 1964 presidential election, announced by singer John Hendricks.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Dizzy Gillespie campaign for president needs a campaign song. Hey! And we have prepared for you a campaign song. It is entitled Vote Dizzy.
Vote Dizzy.
You want to make government a barrel of fun?
Vote Dizzy, vote Dizzy.
You want to make politics a groovy thing?
Vote Dizzy, vote Dizzy.
You get a good president who really can swing? Show the Republic where it is. Vote for a Democratic deal. You want a good president who's willing to run?
Vote Dizzy, vote Dizzy.
You want to make government a barrel of fun? You ought to spend your money in a groovy way every cent. Get that badge for the people, only candidate. Dizzy for president.
In American primaries, you have the option of writing in the name of your own candidate if you don't like the ones put up by the Democrats or the Republicans. Now, the summer of 1963 was a very difficult time. There'd been a lot of race riots across the United States. And at the weekend of September the 20th, which was when the Monterey Festival in California was about to take place, there'd just been a famous firebombing of a black church in Alabama and some children were killed. Now, it just so happened that as a promotional thing for that festival, the critic Ralph Gleason and his wife had produced a number of lapel buttons and other things that said, Dizzy for President. What Gleason said in the wake of that bombing and other things was that somebody with Dizzy's humanitarian principles really ought to be president. And so from being a sort of promotional gimmick, because of the civil rights incidents that occurred, suddenly Dizzy was on a platform as a potential president.
Dizzy's biographer, Alan Shipton. Gleason's message was underlined by the assassination a couple of months later of President Kennedy, followed by his brother Robert, Malcolm X, and Martin Luther King, for whom Dizzy wrote this memorial composition. Dizzy nearly stood for president again in 1972 against Nixon, despite suspicions that his gesture was just a protest. But he withdrew his candidature anyway. Digby Fairweather.
I think the idea of Dizzy Gillespie for president was great fun, but really he stood about as much chance of getting into the White House as Screaming Lord Sutch had of getting into number 10 when you think about it.
I was very serious about it, but being a member of the Baha'i faith, they state that we are not permitted to participate in party politics. And it's beneath our dignity to aspire to political office in the way that it is done now. So that's out, my being president. They'll have to wait. Maybe I run for president of the world or something like that, because we do believe that the world is going to be unified sometime. So if I can stick around long enough, maybe I'll be a candidate for president of the world.
Dizzy did manage on a later trip to Washington to get a photo of President Carter wearing a Dizzy for President button, and the ex-peanut farmer joined him on stage for an impromptu performance of Dizzy's former campaign song.
Salt peanuts, salt peanuts. Salt peanuts, salt peanuts. Salt peanuts, salt peanuts. Salt peanuts, salt peanuts.
Wait, 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 wait. I just wanna ask one question. Would you like to go on the road with us?
I might have to after the night.
Dizzy Gillespie, Max Roach, and Jimmy Carter in 1978 at the White House.